Okay, so we're talking today about Jesus' prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane. So I'm just going to start off by reading the scripture. Okay. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took Peter and the sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour?" he asked Peter. "Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." He went away a second time and prayed, "My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken unless I drink it, may your will be done." When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed the third prayer, saying the same. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour has come. The Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer." So I want to talk about two things. I want to talk about two things on this day: suffering and obedience. It's very easy to consider the good news that Jesus, our Lord and Saviour, died on the cross and took all of the sins of the world, rose again so that we could be in relationship with our Father God in heaven, spend eternity with him there. It is an amazing piece of news to share, and we should absolutely be rejoicing and celebrating in this. But how often do we look at the details of the events of Easter and the events leading up to it? It's not good to get caught up in the suffering. We should be rejoicing that he rose again. But we shouldn't just ignore the suffering either. And there are certainly things that we can learn from. It's also easy to think that because Jesus is our Saviour, he's Lord, he's God on earth, he's made of different stuff than us, right? Pictures like this one make it seem like he's not really human, he's God. So suffering wouldn't be the same for him as it was for us. He wouldn't get it like we do. But I would like to point out that Jesus was fully God while also being fully human. He was born of a human mother. He was hungry. He was tempted, accused, betrayed, abandoned, beaten, spat on, and then nailed to a cross where he died. And none of these things would have hurt him emotionally or physically any less than it would of any one of us. He would have felt every single millimetre of those nails going in just as we would. He was fully human. The thing is, being also fully God meant that he knew what was coming before it happened. So every bit, the betrayal, the beatings, the death on the cross, the pain, every single thing, he knew. So when we look at this scripture and it says, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me." He was in utter turmoil.
You turn it off.
Turn it off. Have I done that? he was in utter turmoil, indescribable distress. Luke says his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. I can't even find the words to explain what must have been going through his head at the moment that he cried out to his heavenly Father with his face in the dirt, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me." Now, he knew that all of this was what he had to do. He knew the scriptures that he was here to fulfill. Yet here he was, simply was Jesus' most human moment. Utterly torn by the sacrifice that was his to fulfill, and his human instinct to not want to go through the emotional and physical torture of the next 24 hours. So what can we learn from this? Just Jesus' prayer itself says to us that we can come to God in our most vulnerable moments and be 100% real with him. Even if we're pretty sure it's not going to go our way. He's a loving Father and he cares about how we feel and what we think. 1 Peter 5 verse 7 says, cast all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. And even if he doesn't change our circumstances, he's with us in it. And he will share the weight of our burdens. Matthew 11 verses 28 to 30 says, come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Also, when we go through suffering, we're not alone. In Deuteronomy it says, he will never leave you nor forsake you. And he certainly never left Jesus in the garden. It may not have been his will to take the cup from Jesus, but he sent an angel to give him peace and get him through. He can and does do this for us too, in our sufferings, if we ask him to. Unfortunately, due to the fall bringing sin into the world, suffering is a very real part of this life. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that if you believe Jesus died for you on the cross and that you live a Christian life, that you won't suffer. It actually says in John 16, in this world you will have trouble, but take heart.
Hallelujah.
I have overcome the world. And Jesus definitely had trouble, and he definitely suffered. But he also lamented through his suffering. And here we see that Jesus begged God three times not to have to go through it. This tells me that we can be on our knees before God, lamenting and asking and begging God to take this cup from us, whatever we may feel our cup may be. And that's okay. We don't have to take hardship on the chin all of the time and be completely okay at all times. Even if we know it's in God's will, or it's something we're going to have to endure, we can also know that God understands. That he won't leave us, that he will give us peace that surpasses all understanding.
Amen.
And that ultimately he sees us through, whether in this life or if not, then in eternity. We know that ultimately death has been defeated. So even if, for reasons we don't always understand, we or our loved ones are not brought out of suffering in this life, we can know that they will spend eternity with a whole new perfect body,
right,
worshipping their Heavenly Father.
So
we know that ultimately, we may not understand the whys and the hows, but we can always trust that God knows best. And that though this world has suffering, eternity doesn't. Because Jesus has conquered death.
Hallelujah.
It tells us that in times of suffering, we are turning to a God that truly cares and fully understands. I have an example of this that's very close to my heart, and he is hands down one of my heroes of the faith. In November last year, my dad was told that he had acute myeloid leukemia. The cancer was at 55% of his bone marrow. It's aggressive and it's fast moving. We were told that if he didn't have treatment, he would only have weeks to live. He spent the whole of December in hospital having chemo. He was let out for like a few hours on Christmas Day. And the low immune system that chemo bought found on a scan that he'd got a fungal infection in his lungs, which made him really poorly. We were all worried about him, but he wasn't. to him, it was, in his words, win-win.
Yeah.
He was either healed or he goes home to be with his Father in heaven.
Right.
He says that not once did he feel alone. Never, God never left his side the whole time he was in hospital. He could physically feel his presence at times. Well, God did heal Dad. After the first round of chemo, Dad's leukemia was in remission. And yes, it can and apparently will, according to the doctors, come back if he doesn't continue with the regular chemo. Because there's no cure, there's only treatment at this point for that leukemia. But after one round of chemo, he was well expected him to be after round six. This is amazing news at this point. He's essentially cancer-free. Then we received news that when they scanned Dad's lungs for his fungal infection, they uncovered what they now know as lung cancer. Completely unrelated, not secondary, but there it was. He had two completely unrelated cancers, which makes treatment complicated, to say the least. So the best option for Dad at this point, they're saying, is surgery. It would mean them taking two-thirds of his lung, but if it was successful, he would again be cancer-free. That said, there were lots of unknowns and variable outcomes that we just didn't know. Dad had surgery at the end of last month, and unfortunately the cancer was too big, and also in his windpipe and sternum, and they were unable to carry out the surgery. We're now waiting to see what the plan is next, what the options are, where we go next. We may not understand why God healed the leukemia and us yet hasn't healed Dad of this. But Dad remains strong.
Right.
Don't get me wrong, he has moments where he worries. But he's not once doubted God in this. Dad has absolutely smashed treatment so far, but he's never taken any credit. When we say to him, like, Dad, you're smashing it, it's not me.
Right.
It's God. All the credit always goes to God, no matter the outcome. Now, we're a big family, and we vowed, as you can probably tell from yesterday's big one, and we vowed to be strong for Dad when all this started. But if I'm honest, he's the one that's kept us going. His strength that comes from God has had a massive knock-on effect. The evening of his surgery, once he'd had surgery, I was scrolling through Facebook, distracting myself from overthinking of what's next in this big journey. And I came across a post that Dad shared. This one. And it reads, "Yet not my will, but yours be done." This doesn't mean that he's giving up asking. He and we and you guys as our church family will continue to pray for Dad's healing. But I believe he's saying, even if you don't, if it's not your will for whatever reason, then I trust you anyway. And this is what Jesus went on to pray. My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me, but not as I will, but as you will. Not my will, but yours. Submission. Obedience. Choosing to trust that God's will is the best for you, even if it isn't what you would choose. When it looks horrific ahead like it did for Jesus, when you have no clue what's next, even in the midst of unanswered prayer, in the waiting, in the suffering, in the what ifs, in the silence, when it feels like you're failing, trust God.
Amen.
Trust that he's there, right there with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Trust that ultimately the battle is already won. Remember that Jesus went through the worst suffering of his life, and what did he do? He fell face down at the feet of his Father. And as Terry was describing last week, he came to God as his Father, like a child to his dad. He said, seriously, if there is any other way in the world that you can do this without me having to do what I've got to do, then do that, please do that. He also didn't want to take no for an answer. He asked him three times. But if not, I choose to trust you. Even in the midst of complete chaos, I trust you. your will be done. I choose to follow you into whatever your will is for me. Obedience. So I want to encourage you all to draw near to God, as near as you can possibly get to your Heavenly Father. So close that you know that you know that His will is always best. That way, when we're in the midst of whatever is in our cup, we will fall at His feet and follow Him into whatever He has for us. And I wonder if we can apply this on another level, or in other ways too. Over Easter, while I was contemplating this prayer of Jesus's, I felt that sometimes God gives us a role or a gift or a calling in our lives that we just don't feel up to, or we might not feel equipped for it, or might feel that it's too big for us, and we're like, oh, I'm just supposed to do that. Like, I've had that many times. But I want to encourage you in the light of this prayer to be real with God about that. Tell Him how you feel. Lament if you need to. Ask Him to give it to someone else if that's how you really feel. But then give it to Him and let Him guide you. And if it's in His will, let it be. Be obedient. Trust Him completely that He knows best. And boldly step into the calling. Not our will, but His be done. Also, let's be inspired by Jesus' prayer. Let us be praying with Jesus as Jesus did. What are our prayers? Are we being real with God when we come to Him? Are we kind of saying, do you know what, I completely trust you, it's fine. Or are we on our face in the dirt saying, this is awful, I don't get it. But not my will, but yours be done. So I just want to take a moment now, I'm going to give you a moment just to kind of consider what you want to bring to God, what you feel like your cup is, what might feel too much in your life. So I'm just going to give you a quiet moment and then I'm going to pray. Father, that today we leave this place with a peace from you.